Hi, and welcome to In the Know. I'm Randy Briggs, your co-host for this evening. Today we have a hell of a show for you. If you think you know your African heritage and your African culture, and if you understand you've been misled in the last 3,000 years, then stand by. Mr. Kawazi,
yes, sir.
Before you go into your presentation, would you please take a few minutes and let our viewing audience know a little bit of stuff about yourself?
Well, first of all, I identify myself as a griot, and for those who are not familiar with the term griot, griot is the ancient term that our ancestors used for those who kept our story alive. And I use that term because if you did not tell the story properly, then they took your life. And I feel that our story needs to be told, and it has not been told. And for 13 years of my life as a griot, as they would call it today, historian, I returned back to Africa on educational tours, taking groups back with a very well-noted historian named Dr. Yusuf Inyakadin. Mm-hmm. For 13 years of my life, traveling the whole 4,200 miles of the Nile, as well as going to West Africa to document our story. Here in the Western world, our story has not been told. In the European educational institutions, we find that little, if any, information is given to us about the foundation that African people laid down of civilization. Mm-hmm. But we can see, once we know our story and go back to Africa, we can see the symbolisms and the African history is all around. Mm-hmm. So this is where I started from, by that little voice in my early years in the European educational institutions, when the first European teacher told me that your people have no history. And that little voice told me to seek. And from that little voice telling me to seek, that seeking took me back to Africa for 13 years now, documenting as well as researching our story.
Mr. Kawazi, how does this service provide, what does this provide for our community? How does it help our community?
Well, we have to realize our condition. And our condition in the community, we suffer from a deep inferiority complex as well as low self-esteem. And this is all due to the fact that what our children know about our history, our culture, is very little of nothing. And not only that, the negativity that we get over the TV is a very self-hatred type of thing that we have in our community, causing youth to kill each other and so forth. So what this provides is not only a cultural connection, but it opens up our African genetic memory bank of who we are as an African people. We have a rich heritage. And once we enter the school system, we will not enter the school system with a very low self-esteem, inferiority complex. We will enter the school system with a confidence to know that learning mathematics, learning writing, learning reading, that our ancestors started at long before the world knew it. Mm. So if the child knows that walking into the classroom, the child would not run from mathematics. The child would not run from writing, knowing that the first writing system known called Meduneter, who the Greeks call hieroglyphics, the first writing system laid down by African people, long before Aramaic, long before Arabic, long before Greek, long before Phoenician, African people brought the first writing known to the world. So when an African child walks into a classroom knowing all this is part of his and her heritage, then how do you think they're going to respond to in the classroom? But if that African child is going to sit in the classroom and all they're going to know is a couple pages of history, and from that point out they're going to get a nothing but Europeans, how they beat up on them, as well as the rest of the world, then how you think they're going to respond in that classroom? Mm. A low self-esteem and self-hate and inferiority complexes will come out of that. And this is what we provide in the community by raising up the mind of African people and our African children, and start, above all, to instill the institutional building of our own.
Mr. Kawazi, now I'm sitting here looking at an African-American man, and I can imagine that Martin Luther King and H. Rap Brown and Huey Newton, all the black leaders are generation. And you just got through going through a spiel here, and you taught me so much in the last 2 minutes. What inspired you to become this dedicated to what you...
The great ancestors you just mentioned of, especially Malcolm X, and in fact I wear him on my shirt. My wife, in fact, made this shirt, and many others in our history. This was the inspiration and the will and the power that they brought our story to life. So my inspiration came from the legacy that they laid down. We have to go back and look at what our ancestors laid down for us. You've got to look at your past to understand your present, to understand your future. If you know nothing about your past, you will not move for the future. You will find yourself at a very idle position in the present. And that's where we are right now, because keep in mind the Emancipation Proclamation of 1865 was the freeing of the body taking the chains off the body. But those chains were taken off the body and put on the brain. And right now we are suffering from mental and psychological and spiritual enslavement. In fact, cultures, Asian and other ethnic cultures that come here, they come here with a culture intact. And for the most part, most of them have reaped off of what African people have laid down. The white movement, all other ethnic groups, whether it be Koreans, Chinese, and all these other ethnic groups that come here, and even the Europeans are coming here today, are benefiting from the struggle that African people laid down, and some of those you just mentioned was Malcolm X and Martin Luther King and others, and we presently are reaping very little from the blood that they have laid down today. And that's why we've got to go back and have a global consciousness, not just locked up in the birdcage of America. We have got to have global consciousness. And having global consciousness, we can understand a whole global view of history and see what has been taking place on this history. And we'll find that not only do you find Africans on the continent, but you find Africans all over the planet Earth. So we are not a minority. We are a majority on this planet.
I tell you what, you're laying down some heavy stuff. I'm not going to ask you any more questions. I want you to get to this presentation and show these people exactly what you're talking about.
This African right here, also of the 12th dynastic period, called Amenahet. He put Amen at the beginning of his name, and you say Amen at the end of your prayers for the god that he gave praise to, an African god. Amenahet, who built a great wall, unlike the wall of Jericho that you can't find nowhere, his great wall is still there. His nose has been hacked out. He's still there in the Cairo Museum for us to see. These are the Africans of the Nile Valley. He also had a sister to rule the throne also, called Sobek Neferu, showing the sisters ruled the throne even long before Hatshepsut.
Brothers and sisters, I returned back to the Cairo Museum in the summer of 1994, and now Amenahet III is no longer there. The psychopathic racists have removed him so we could not see our African pharaoh of the 12th dynastic period. This returned back to the Cairo Museum for an eyewitness account.
As I was saying before, this is my 14th year of coming here. Many of my years of coming here, I've seen things have been missing, taken away. This year, I've been totally not only disappointed, dejected, sad state, outraged. But right here is what stood the colossal of Amenahet III, who built his pyramid in Harawa. No longer here. This is the brother's colossal that stood right here. That's no longer in here. This was a pharaoh of the 12th dynastic period. Although I said there's no one prototype that defines an African facial characteristic, but clearly we can see who he is by his African features. Rahotep and Nefret, he was not a pharaoh and a king that you looked at around the corner, but that's what they exposed to you at all times. Where did Amenahet III go? It's not here anymore. Many Africans will come through here and will not see Amenahet III because of the racism of the Western world to take out anything indigenous to the African people of the Nile Valley. Gone. Stood right here for 14 years of my life coming back here. And then they're going to tell you that don't be a reverse racist. When we're being a victim of racism every day. And here we have Menahotep the first. He was over here. They have now moved him over here. And he stabilized the land of Kemet, because at that time the invasions was coming in at that time to the Asiatics. And he is known as a reunifier of ancient Kemet during his time. Take a good look, because we don't know how long he will be here. And only thing, fortunately, I do have a picture of Amenhotep III. Still, the Western world controls this museum. Europeans control it and do everything to try to eradicate the indigenous African people.
Brothers and sisters, let's return back to our 1996 tour, where I found Amenhotep III thrown in the back room where he cannot be seen by the public.
Sisters, as I said before, many years I've come here, and Amenhotep III that you see right here was in the front, along with all the other Middle Kingdom pharaohs. And I came a year ago and I noticed that he was missing. I didn't know where he was at. And it wasn't until I came back, after searching throughout all the museum, I find him in a back corner. In this back corner, with pieces that you see are broken up, he is a major pharaoh of the 12th dynastic period, a time of high literature, a time that it was known as the second golden age of Kemet. This is a brother who took and built the pyramids in Hawara. This is the brother who made the black capstone put on top of this pyramid that you just saw. But why is he in the back corner? But you're going to see Nefret and Rahotep, those two figures. Once you see them, you'll recognize them, because you see them in all the books in America. That's who they show you, who were irrelevant, who were not pharaohs, who did not build major sites and so forth. And one even questioned if they had anything to do with this. But we got a question: why is Amenhotep the third all the way in the back room, in the back corner, for no one to see him, where he's been systematically moved out of the way? And I'm saying that this brother built his pyramid, like I said, in the area of Hawara. He's known as building the labyrinth, which is a very elaborate structure. Many rooms were in this labyrinth. So all the things that he did, but the racism of the Western world, this is where we have Amenhotep III. So let me read something to you. This is how vicious this can get. Abdullah, can you hold this for me? This part here. Now, let me read something to you. We have time? Abdullah, thank you. Now, this is time, February 3rd, 1992. This article is an essay by Robert Hughes. Excuse me, we have a private group here. It says, the Afrocentrist claim can be summarized quite easily. It says that history of the cultural relationships between Africa and Europe is bunk, a prop for a fiction of white European supremacy. Paleo historians agree that intelligent human life began in the Rift Valley of Africa. Afrocentrists go further. They go on to say that Africa was the cultural father of us all. European culture derived from Egypt, and Egypt is part of Africa, linked to its heart by the artery of the Nile. Egyptian civilization began in sub-Saharan Africa, in Ethiopia and Sudan that I dealt with yesterday. Now look how he sums up. Listen to how he sums up this paragraph. This is what Robert Hughes says in Time, February 3rd, 1992. He says, no plausible evidence exists in these claims of Egyptian negritude. Will you read that, ma'am, right there? I don't want you to think that I'm making this up. Read the date, and then you read this line right here, out loud for everybody to sit here.
Time, February 3rd, 1992. No plausible evidence exists for these claims of Egyptian negritude.
So that now they tell you, don't be a reverse racist, when we've been a victim of racism every day. In the books, they say if you want to keep something from black folks, put it in a book. But let's go further. Arnold Toynbee, he's a real toy, he says this: when we classify mankind by color, the only one of the primary races which has not made a creative contribution to any one of our 21 civilizations is the black race. And who do we have right here? Amenhotep III looking at you, looking back at you from almost 4,000 years ago. That's why you cannot know your story. This is, but yet at the same time, they systematically hide the colossal pieces in the back room and then go through a thing of passing the others that they put out front to make you think this is a white civilization. And then no one prototype that defines an African facial characteristic. We got thin nose, thick lips, and also wide nose. Many variations of colors of African people. But systematically, they have knocked off the ones that got wide nose and thick lips, just like you saw Horm Achate, where Napoleon blew off the nose. These are the things that's being done right now today.
Here's another colossal statue, brothers and sisters, that has been taken out of the Cairo Museum. The last time I saw it was in 1985. I wonder what Robert Hughes from Time Magazine would say about this African right here. Although there's no one prototype that defines an African facial characteristics, but we see that the Africans with full lips and nose are systematically being taken out. Let's continue with the live lecture to see what Newsweek has to say about this.
But now Newsweek came out September 23rd, 1991. Now we got a little test here. Question. Were the ancient Egyptians black Africans? Now that we're going to get research, answer. Egypt was home to the blacks now. But they also now, through multicultural, trying to include themselves, Asians and Semites. Some pharaohs were black, including the dynastic founders. Cleopatra was probably Greek. I'll deal with her in a few minutes. But let's go on. Let's deal with who was indigenous to the Nile Valley. The Temerians, who lived in Lower Egypt, which was the north, who was indigenous to the Nile Valley, called Egyptians. Today, the Hyksos invaded. They were the troglodytes, the sand dwellers, who came in 1675 BC, who invaded during the 13th dynasty, had nothing to do with the Nile Valley. The Ta-Nehisians from the ancient Kushite civilization, and also the ancient kingdom of Ta-Seti, going back over 26,000 years before white folks were even on the scene. The Tamahu people, who invaded from the west, who came across the Mediterranean, attacked Egypt from Libya from the west. You could see them with their tattoos. They were nothing but barbarian beasts, even back then. See the tattoos on him?
So, brothers and sisters, let's return back to the Cairo Museum to see an eyewitness account of the model that our African ancestors left us of the Temerians, now called Egyptians today, and the Ta-Nehisians, now called Nubians today, that the African Nile Valley was their home, not the Asians and the Semites, as Newsweek tell us, as they were called in ancient times, the Hyksos. Let's return back for an eyewitness account.
Brothers and sisters, again, Europeans have always tried to divide Upper and Lower Egypt. Here we see the Kemetic Africans, the indigenous people of the African Nile Valley. And keep in mind, as I said before, there's no one prototype that defines an African facial characteristic, hair texture, even color. Black people produce white. Albinism. Now, we see that the Kemetic brothers, the Ta-Nehisians, who came from the south, their origins go all the way back to an ancient kingdom called Ta-Seti. But we know even in the 25th dynasty where their fame, where they came in to help Kemet, because Kemet was invaded by many foreign invasions. But also we see right here the Temerians, who lived in Lower Egypt. But they were one African nation. You don't go into Europe and divide the French from the British, or divide the British from the Italians. They're all Europeans. So why do they come into Africa and divide the Ta-Nehisians from the Temerians? Even in Europe, you find that the Greeks and the Italians are a darker hue of white than the Swedes and the British, who live way in the north. So just like our Temerian brothers who lived in the north, they were of African origin, as well as our brothers who lived in the south, the Ta-Nehisians, were of African origins. Even you can see the various colors even among us right here. But Europeans have repeatedly tried to separate the Ta-Nehisians, who they call the Nubians today, which we're going tomorrow to Nubia, from the rest of Egypt, which in fact they were all one nation. That's why the Ta-Nehisians or the Nubians always gave praise to the god of Kemet and the goddess of Kemet, because it was also their culture. They didn't come in and plunder and pillage like the Hyksos, the Assyrians, the Persians, the Greeks, the Freaks, and the Romans, and all the others. They didn't do this. because it was also their culture. But this is all done through divide and conquer. By dividing our culture as a people and try to think that we are something other than who we are. But this is one African nation, one in the north, one in the south. The Ta-Nehisians and the Temerians. That's why Norma, the first king who came from the south, showing the origins, came from the interior of Africa. See, the war is here.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, our people don't know it's a war.
Because they don't want us to know what we are.
Indigenous Africans from the Nile Valley, the Temerians and the Ta-Nehisians. The Hyksos was an invader and the Tamahu was an invader. So it had nothing to do with no Asians and Semites. Even Marin Jehudi talks about how the Hyksos invaded across the desert and coming into our land. He says, unexpectedly from the region of the east came men of unknown race. Confident of the victory, they marched against our land. By force, they took it easy without a single battle. Having overpowered our rulers, they burned our cities without compassion and destroyed the temples. All the people were treated with great cruelty, for they slew some and carried off the wives of children of others into slavery. Doesn't that sound like a familiar account? This is the invasion of the Hyksos around 1675 BC. But here we see Second Enrei, who lost his life in the 17th dynasty on the battlefield of the freeing and liberation of African people. And it was his son, Ahmose the First, who expelled these people out of our land. Go and read Josephus' work. He said, the only expulsion of a large group of people is when this African right here named Ahmose the First, the liberator, the emancipator of African people, who expelled these Hyksos invaders out of our land. And guess what he hollered on the battlefield?
What?
Never again. Never again. This was over 3,000 years ago, and his nose has been hacked out too. And some even say that Moses' name may have actually been Ahmose the First expelling the Hyksos. In fact, we're going to see his beautiful wife, Nefertari, who helped the liberation of Africa and opened up the 18th dynasty at this particular time, and her name means the most beautiful, Nefertari. She lived 1,500 years before some woman named Cleopatra. Cleopatra was at the end of the dynastic period of Egypt. Let's deal with Cleopatra, because here's Newsweek. Was Cleopatra black? Let's look at the tricks of how white folks do us. Why did they put Cleopatra on the scene for us to argue with? Because they know that this is the Greco-Roman period, and they know that Cleopatra had a Ptolemy father, who was from Europe, a Persian mother, meaning she had nothing to do with Africa. But we knew nothing about Nefertari. 1,500 years, this was the heart of the African kingdom before the Greek freaks and Romans and others were on the scene. So with us sitting up arguing if Cleopatra's black, it makes it laughable. But when we go back to this, this is not laughable. Why didn't they put her on the cover? Huh? So Cleopatra had nothing to do with Africa. She was of Persian and Ptolemy origins. That's why we got to know the chronological history of Kemet. Now we go on to see, why didn't they put Makari Hatshepsut on the cover? Long before some Cleopatra, over 1,000 years before her, who gave us the diaphragm by grinding up the acacia tree because she didn't want to become impregnated when she was on the throne. Her father, Thutmose the First, went to the priest and said, let her take the throne. And she ruled the throne and also protected Egypt during that time, because no Hyksos invaded during that time. Tells us she must have been a very powerful sister. Huh? This sister here, I put our little sister right here because she looks just like Makari Hatshepsut. In fact, this is her architect, Senmut. I really love the brother, little clarity brother. Really love the brother because he got his nose intact. But I especially love him too because he looks just like my son that I took back, as you see right here. Shana Jean is still going on. Got the same ears, nose, and everything. Shana Jean is still traveling on. In fact, this is her temple that Senmut built for Makari Hatshepsut, that means Zetzret Zetzru, the most select and holy of places. Looks like it was built yesterday, carved out of stone right here. And on this temple, it talks about her expedition back to the land of Punt, because she wanted to go back to her ancestral spiritual homeland. And she went there and met the queen of Paria there, and the Punt, presently Somalia today. And we see the sisters were always blessed in this area right here. And when the white boys came in, much, much later, and they talked about the buttocks of the sisters. In fact, that's where you get the bustles from. The bustles came from because the white woman, they wanted some of that African buttocks there. You got to come to see my wife's presentation. The cultural destruction of Africa seen through fashion is serious. She's going to deal with this very heavy. And we go on to see, now glamour comes out. A better butt fast they want.
It goes on to say, we've moved away from those small, flat buttocks featured in those beach towel blankets. We want a round, sculptured butt. In fact, we want a class butt. There's only one class butt, and that's our little sisters in interior of Africa. We want a class butt. A class butt. There's only one class butt. So, brothers, do the right thing by keeping your eyes on the real thing before you end up with a handful of silicone today.
Brothers and sisters, let's return back to Kemet to see Makari Hatshepsut's funerary temple, to see how Arabs and Muranthropoid Europeans tried to stop us from telling our story.
As Shoghi just mentioned to you, this is a very beautiful relief telling of the story of Makari Hatshepsut, or her name as it means in the spirit, the Ka of Ra. She's speaking of her expedition back to her spiritual homeland, back to the land of Punt, or Punit. And it is here that not only did she bring back many herbs and spices, but she even decorated her temple to look like the interior of Africa, as you can see right here. Now, when it speaks of the officers that came with her, as you see the brothers right here, they speak of him as Nihisi. Let me read from you to you in one of the guidebooks that they have for sale. And it speaks of this very relief that you can't be on the other side. I'm the only one that should be on the other side of the bars here.
Yours only because you have many cassettes.
You see the scenes?